Welcome to BCRF Zoom. This is Margaret Flowers, Director of the Research Program. And I'm thrilled to be joined today by Dr. Lisa Carey, a medical oncologist and clinical researcher at the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill, and BCRF investigator. Dr. Carey is joining us today to talk to us about treatments for early stage breast cancer or breast cancers that are still localized to the breast area and haven't spread to distant tissues. And Dr. Carey, I'm thrilled that you're joining us today, and I want to thank you for taking time out of your busy schedule. And before we begin, I'd like to just ask if you could introduce yourself to our audience.
Certainly, Margaret. It's a great pleasure to be here. I'm Lisa Carey. I'm a medical oncologist clinician and a clinical researcher at the University of North Carolina Lineberger Comprehensive Cancer Center.
Great. Well, again, thanks so much for joining us. And you know, we've seen a really dramatic decline in deaths from breast cancer over the last 2.5 decades, down 40% since the late 80s, early 90s. And what do you contribute to, you know, the most significant contribution to that trend?
You know, it's actually, I have to say, breast cancer has been, a game of singles as opposed to home runs, but there's been a lot of them. I think the major difference over these last few decades has been probably in the improvement in therapies and the ability to prevent relapses. But you can't ignore the advances in radiation, the advances in surgery, and the impact of screening so that patients are presenting with smaller tumors that are much easier to manage.
So, you know, the most common type of breast cancer is also in some ways the most treatable. The breast cancers mm-hmm. that rely on estrogen, require estrogen to grow. We've had targeted therapies to that essentially prevent the tumors from getting that essential estrogen, and they've been very effective for that very large group of patients with that type of breast cancer, but not all breast cancers respond to these therapies because they don't require estrogen to grow. So what are some of the successes that we're seeing in some of the less common breast cancers, such as HER2-positive and triple-negative breast cancer?
Yeah, you know, I mean, you raise an incredibly important point. You know, it's worth noting that, you know, precision medicine started in breast cancer with anti-estrogen targeted therapies that have been around for decades and decades. You know, the 20-30% of breast cancers that are not hormone receptor positive and are essentially insensitive to anti-estrogen approaches have been fall in two categories, really. The HER2 positive group, some of which actually do have both hormone receptors and HER2, and those we have lots of things to shoot at. And HER2 positive breast cancer, we've had a remarkable run of, you know, really recent over the last 15 years of multiple drugs that are highly effective in preventing relapse in that group, which went from the worst prognosis group to one of the best, just by virtue of these amazing drugs that have been developed, like trastuzumab, pertuzumab, trastuzumab, emtansine, and others. Triple negative is the other group, which is essentially defined by what it doesn't have. It doesn't have hormone receptors that are expressed on the tumor. It doesn't have HER2 overexpression. And if you think about it, that highlights the problem we have, which is that it's probably more heterogeneous than we clinically recognize. I think on a molecular and biologic basis, we're getting a handle on that. But essentially, since we don't have any of the conventional clinical targets, HER2 and the hormone receptors, we're reliant on chemotherapy. Mm-hmm. Now, the truth is that triple negative has also had an improvement in outcomes and prognosis because the chemo drugs that we give are better. And we are entering into the era of immunotherapy, which is already being given in the metastatic setting, and many of us anticipate will also be incorporated into early breast cancer. But triple negative remains our thorniest challenge at the moment.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Going back to the HER2 positive, it's an mm-hmm. excellent example, as you said, where we went from very limited treatment options and really a deadly disease to one where we've got multiple targeted therapies and have dramatically improved the survival and as you said, reducing the risk of recurrence. So now that we have so many options to choose from, how are there tests or tools that, you know, like the Oncotype DX test that we have it for ER positive breast cancer, where doctors can tell if a patient needs an aggressive chemotherapy treatment versus not. Are there similar tools, or are we getting to where we'll have similar tools for patients who are in an early stage HER2 positive that might not need chemotherapy, or being able to really tailor their therapy the way we're able to now tailor therapy for ER positive breast cancer?
You know, Margaret, that's an incredibly great question. The short answer is yes. I genuinely believe that we will have the ability to better gauge the aggressiveness of HER2 positive breast cancer and decide which tumors need less therapy, particularly less chemotherapy, and which need, you know, the whole kitchen sink thrown at them in order to help prevent relapse. We're not there yet, but there are some things that have already come out of studies that we and other people have done that look like we will have assays and biomarkers that may help us do that. And as you know, right now, we know that we can tailor therapy based on geography. So the cancer is small and it's only in the breast, it's not in the local lymph nodes, and we can be a little less aggressive than if the tumor's in the lymph nodes or it's larger. But we want to get past that. And it's true that if you just go by anatomy, we're probably not going to be able to do much tailoring or optimization mm-hmm. of therapy. And we end up overtreating a lot of people with these drugs that take a year to finish or sometimes longer. But I think we're pretty close. There's some great ideas and some great assays being developed that relate to the biology of the cancer. That's, you know, the HER2 positive breast cancer, which is, these can be very heterogeneous. And also really importantly, the nature of the immune system and how your natural immune system is reacting. And is it seeing the cancer, and can it help control the cancer? That it turns out is super important.
So do you sort of have, I'm not going to ask you to use your crystal ball, but how far away do you think we are from seeing those things? Maybe, I mean, are they at the clinical trial stage where we're seeing them mm-hmm. tested in clinical trials? And so when would we, how close are we to seeing those things come to the clinic?
You know, a few years, I would say. It's not tomorrow. Mm-hmm. It's not within this year, but there are definitely trials that are testing, you know, hypotheses about whether you can look at certain elements of the tumor, and if they work, like let's just say, for example, if the immune system can be reflected by looking at what are called tumor infiltrating lymphocytes, which a pathologist can just see on the microscope when they look at the cancer, they can tell whether there's these immune cells in and around the tumor. And if that turns out to be important in enough sets of trials, you know, we may be able to do that pretty quickly. You know, simply because it's easy. If it depends on more sophisticated kinds of testing, that might be a couple more years. But I have to say, I think we're going to have, we're going to treat HER2 positive breast cancer in a much more granular way and not just lump it all together mm-hmm. Within the next year or two. Mm-hmm. Getting really good at it and really tailored, I think, is going to be a few years.
And that's exciting. That's really mm-hmm. wonderful to see this arc of progress. And like you said, you're not hitting home runs, we're getting singles, but those singles are really important. So going back to triple negative breast cancer, and you spoke briefly about it's very complex disease, and it's, you know, we call it triple negative because it doesn't have those common markers of the hormone receptors and HER2, but it's not just one disease, it's a group of diseases. And so, you know, in part, I know that's one reason why there's not like a treatment that is going to be broadly applied. But what are some of the challenges in finding targeted therapies that can benefit more patients? I mean, so still, even though we've made progress, you know, the therapies that are targeted for patients with triple negative are still only benefiting a small portion of people with triple negative. So what are the challenges here?
You know, well, I think you've outlined them beautifully. You know, the challenges are sort of twofold. One is we don't quite have as good a handle on the underlying biology in a reproducible way of triple negative breast cancer in a way that you can say, so, you know, if you were to look at something and say, okay, if I look at this group are likely to be treated well with that targeted therapy and lets me get away from chemo. You know, that's been harder to do in triple negative. There are fewer low hanging fruit than there were in certainly in HER2 positive breast cancer, which HER2 alone in HER2 positive breast cancer drives the cancer cell to a large degree, not all of them, but a high proportion of them. And so just whacking HER2 works really well. Triple negative, you know, it doesn't have like that sort of big fat juicy target. And so, you know, you're looking to tease them out, but it's not as obvious. You know, you got to climb the tree a little higher to, mm-hmm. to find it. That said, I think that just as the immune system is important for HER2 positive breast cancer, it certainly looks like it affects prognosis and response to therapy in triple negative breast cancer. And there are some studies coming out that suggest that if you incorporate immunotherapy upfront with chemotherapy, the patients may do better. And we'll know for sure whether that's the case in the next year or two, at which point we'll be using immunotherapy fairly broadly. And what I suspect is we will have a way to gauge the tumors most likely to respond to that. We will still have the challenge of those that what we call immune cold tumors, mm-hmm. where they, you know, the immune system doesn't seem to be recognizing the cancer, and it doesn't matter if you activate it, it doesn't see the cancer. So we need to, you know, some cancers sort of throw an invisibility cloak over themselves and they just hide. And so we have to figure out ways to pull that back so they can be visible. I think those are probably the main approaches. There are some newer drugs that are being given that also are less toxic in terms of chemotherapy. And I think we'll be working more and more with those. You know, we're getting smarter at how to give chemotherapy than we used mm-hmm. to be. So even simple things like that can be part of the advances for patients.
Mm-hmm. So what I'm hearing, and I think it's important to reiterate, is that when someone's diagnosed with breast cancer, it's not just breast cancer. And you know, we're talking about different types and different biologies. And so, you know, what kind of recommendations do you have for someone who's just been diagnosed with breast cancer about talking to their doctor about tailoring their therapy, about getting the right therapy for their particular type of breast cancer?
Well, you know, I think it depends on where they are. And I think, you know, certainly they should be having a conversation with their oncologists, you know, all of their oncologists, right? The surgeon, the radiation, the medical oncologist, because, you know, we treat our patients best in terms of tailoring and optimizing their therapy when those doctors all talk to each other and treat the patient, you know, in the center of the discussion and the decision-making. So I would make sure that that's happening. I think when it comes to just the decisions within the medical field and the medical oncologist, you know, I think patients, so my patients are their own best advocates, right? They will they pressure test my decision making. They ask me why. That's totally appropriate. I love it. And they should ask, what are the options and why are your recommendations going in this direction as opposed to that direction? And I think they should be proactive about that. If a cancer is unusual in some feature or particularly aggressive, lots of lymph nodes, things like that, I would probably seek out a second opinion at an academic center just to make sure that that there aren't things that are coming available or are available there that aren't available in the community. And I think that's a perfectly reasonable thing to do. Most of us are attached to our community docs quite tightly and are happy to help any way we can. And I think, let me just say one last thing, which I think is super important. And I'm thinking about it because I just got off a call with my patient advocates for research group. And they are, you know, they think that the patients are partners in terms of when we do, you know, BCRF is supporting a ton of research into trying to understand the biology of these cancers better and helping us optimize therapy better, which you have to start with understanding the biology. And patients are our partners. So if they have an opportunity to be part of a tissue-based study or a clinical trial, they should take advantage of it and they should find out more about that.
Mm-hmm. I wanted to go back to your comment about second opinions, because I'm thinking that a patient that has just, you know, learned that maybe they have an aggressive cancer and maybe should get a second opinion might feel like that, you know, that might be a hurdle, that it might, you know, they might be afraid that they would have to travel somewhere to do that. And then it would push back their time of treatment. Can you comment a little bit on just the process of getting a second opinion?
Sure. Oh, absolutely. So I think the first thing to remember is that breast cancer is not a thing that changes day by day or week by week. So it really is something where you know, I think taking the time to dot the I's and cross the T's, you know, doesn't lose anything. It's not months and months, but a short time doing that, I think is not dangerous and perfectly appropriate. Generally, most places get patients in pretty quickly, particularly a new diagnosis. It's also true that in this era, we're doing more and more virtual visits of this kind, so that a patient can have a formal visit, but it's without having to, you know, leave the comfort of their own home. You know, I did a bunch of them yesterday where I was in the clinic and the patient was in their kitchen. And so that's another opportunity that I think, you know, it's the, you know, a small silver lining of this awful viral pandemic is that we are able to do these and they have been facilitated. And to be honest, our patients have wanted to do them for years and so have we. So I think there are some other opportunities where the patient then can get a feel for whether there's any real tangible value added to physically coming in to a center. Mm-hmm. Sometimes they have to come in if the surgeon and the medical oncologist have to measure the tumor and see whether they agree with the lymph nodes and the things like that. And then I think, then sometimes that's just a decision that they would have to make to come in at least at one time.